Today we are in the mountains of southern Arizona, and we are looking for the splendid royal moth caterpillar, scientifically known as Citheronia splendens, and this is one of the most spectacular species of caterpillar that can be found in this state. And in my experience, they aren't all that common, so I'm only looking to find a couple. Before we start looking for royal moth caterpillars, there's something else quite interesting that I want to show you here. These are Western Hercules beetles, Dynastes grantii. The one that we have on the left, as you would expect, is the male, and the one on the right with no horns is the female. These are a species of rhinoceros beetle. I found the male because it flew onto me at night, and the female was laying on its back in the road, and I held onto them overnight so that I could show you them today. This is perhaps the most iconic species of beetle that is associated with the state of Arizona, and certainly one of the most easily recognizable. For many species of rhinoceros beetles, the easiest way to find them is by attracting them to a light at night, but during the day, the adults of many species can be incredibly difficult to locate. But these Western Hercules beetles are a bit of an exception, and it's their feeding behavior that makes it possible to locate them during the day. These beetles like to hang out on ash trees. They strip off the outer layer of bark on the branches of these trees to access the sap, which is their food. Their affinity for ashes is such that they often end up mating in those trees as well, both diurnally and nocturnally. These Western Hercules beetles are well known for having this sort of old banana peel look, as are some other species in the Dynastes genus. The female that we have here looks pretty standard, but you may have noticed a discolored spot on the corner of the male's elytron. This sort of defect, if I can call it that, is not too rarely seen in this species. But what is interesting is that sometimes this defect affects the entire body, making these Western Hercules beetles look more like your average rhinoceros beetle. But as far as I can tell, this is quite a rare occurrence. Though I did not find the beetles here, they should be perfectly fine in this habitat, so I'm going to leave them here. We have our first splendid royal moth caterpillar, and right now it is currently eating some leaves, though we have to get a better angle. There you can see it munching away, and right off the bat you can tell this is quite a large species of caterpillar. And these caterpillars have to be NPCs because as I squeeze them, because, you know, who can resist, they continue eating their leaves. This individual that we are looking at is a late instar. If I had to guess, this one is going to pupate sometime this week or next week. The caterpillars don't get too much larger than the one that we have here. Even still, this is one of the most massive caterpillars that can be found in Arizona. It lives in the southeast of the state, as well as southwestern New Mexico, and throughout much of Mexico. And as opposed to the larvae, the adults can only be found in July and August, in the United States. As you would expect, this moth is also quite large, and unlike the caterpillars, the moths throughout their range look pretty much identical to one another, and this discrepancy in variation is a fairly common trend in Lepidoptera. Down here on the ground is a species of grasshopper that I really wanted to show you today. This is the rainbow grasshopper, Dactylotum bicolor. It has that common name for quite an obvious reason, but why it has the specific epithet bicolor is not as obvious. The term bicolor usually means two colors or two tones, as you would expect, but this grasshopper that we have here clearly exhibits more than two colors. When I first found this species a few years ago, I was curious about how they got this name, so I looked at photos of these grasshoppers from many different regions, thinking that at least one of the populations exhibits only two colors. And while they do vary quite a bit in appearance, as far as I can tell, all populations exhibit at least three colors. So I read the 1843 publication in which these were described to see if there was an explanation in there, but unfortunately there was not. So in the absence of additional clues, we can assume that this is one of those cases in which an author used the term bicolor to refer to an organism that is highly contrasted instead of having two colors. This is a usage that has fallen out of favor in taxonomy over time. This species should be the most colorful grasshopper that can be found in the United States, but there are a few others in this state that come close, and one of those I think is also worth taking a look at, so I'll try to find one for you later. This coloration that these rainbow grasshoppers have is an extreme example of aposematism, and this is thought to be the case because birds avoid them, and there is evidence that lizards do as well. There's a tiny patchnose snake down there on the ground. These are really quick, so maybe it's not a great idea to catch this one on camera. Got it. This is an eastern patchnose snake, Salvadora grahamiae. and this one is just a juvenile. The adults of this species can reach over a meter in length. And of course, these are called patchnose snakes because they have an enlarged rostral scale. That's the one that you see on the nose. This is characteristic of about half of all Salvadora species. Just like any other racer ecomorph, these feed predominantly on lizards. More specifically, they have a preference for whiptails, or Aspidosculus. But they also feed on eggs, small mammals, and nestling birds. There are a couple of other patchnose snake species found in this region, and this eastern patchnose that we have here can generally be distinguished from those two others by having two bold dorsal stripes and no thin lateral stripes parallel to them, which is what you would see in the others. Also, in this area, we are close to the western limit of their range. These are also found throughout New Mexico, West Texas, and northern Mexico. I once saw one of these snakes resting near an active ant nest, and when I approached it, it escaped directly into the tunnels. I'm not too sure if that was a mistake or not. This beetle that we have climbing around here is a Dendrobias mandibularis, or more commonly known as the long-jawed longhorn beetle. Having found a female is slightly unfortunate. Please don't cancel me. The reason being that they don't really exemplify the common name long-jawed longhorn beetle. It's the males that morphologically are quite spectacular, by contrast. They have mandibles that are several times longer than the ones that we see here on this female. This feature makes this species quite special among diurnal longhorn beetles that are found in the United States. And the reason for this is that it's overwhelmingly nocturnal longhorn beetles that have that kind of sexual dimorphism. Part of what indicates that this is a diurnal species is that it's colorful. These Dendrobias live in bushes and shrubs, and I can't say that I've seen all that many, but desert brooms appear to be a popular choice for these beetles to live in, and that is the plant that this one is currently on. And actually, desert brooms are one of the best plants to check for insects during the monsoons. This plant is highly popular for both herbivorous and carnivorous species during daytime hours. And last thing about this beetle, it is fairly widely distributed. It can be found from the southern states in this country all the way down to Central America. We have our second Citheronia splendens here in this plant. And this one, you can tell, doesn't have quite the same coloration as the last one. And that's because it's an earlier instar. This one appears to be about two-thirds the size of the last one that we found. One of the more noticeable differences between the penultimate and ultimate instar is the coloration on the scoli, or horns. You can see that the larger horns on this one have black tips, whereas the last one did not. The plant that this one is feeding on is the desert cotton, otherwise known as Gossypium thurberi. It's the same plant that we found the last one on as well. Here in the United States, this is the preferred host plant of the splendid royal moth. This plant is only found in southeastern Arizona, Sonora, and western Chihuahua. In 2016, this cotton was assessed by IUCN as being a globally endangered species. Part of the cause for this endangerment was an attempt at eradicating this species in Arizona in the 1930s. And that movement started because this plant was thought to be a source of cotton boll weevils. This was a problem because Arizona produces a lot of cotton. It's estimated that peak cotton cultivation accounted for as much as 42% of this state's agricultural sector at one point in time. But it was later found that the weevil living on these native cottons doesn't actually affect the cultivated species. And this eradication movement likely caused a sharp decline in the splendid royal moth population. And today, this moth is assessed at the national level as being critically imperiled, vulnerable, or a status in between the two. Might be difficult to see, but we have a mating pair of grasshoppers in this bush. And this is the species that I mentioned earlier when we found the rainbow grasshopper. Maybe I can get a better angle from the side here. There they are. I don't want to spook them just yet. These are Poecilotettix pantherinus, the panther-spotted grasshopper. And as I said, this is a mating pair, which is why I'm being careful not to spook them, and the smaller one on the top is the male. And at least in my experience, this species can be a little bit tricky to find, so finding a mating pair like the one that we have here is quite a good find. This is the first time I've been able to observe this. These grasshoppers are found in Arizona and Mexico, and there's only one other species in the Poecilotettix genus. That one is found in the United States, and is much less restricted than the species that we have here. And though these adults are quite showy, the smaller instars tend to be a bit more drab in color, though they are still speckled. Those earlier instars are especially lacking in blue, not yellow. And unlike the rainbow grasshopper that we were looking at earlier, These exhibit almost no variation in their appearance across their distribution. And lastly, as is the case with many other grasshoppers in this region, these ones are associated with the monsoons. We have a caterpillar down here on this plant, and this one is a Proserpinus terlooii, otherwise known as the Terloo Sphinx. And I know it doesn't look like much, but I did not just randomly come across this one. I was deliberately looking for this species, because just like the royal moth caterpillars that we are looking for today, these are also considered to be imperiled. This species is critically imperiled, to be exact, and this is at the state and national level. These caterpillars are easily recognizable in this area. This is because the two columns of eyelets that they have on the sides of their body are a unique feature among the Lepidoptera in this region. And as is the case with many caterpillars, the larger eyelets are placed closer to the head, where the body is a little bit fatter. This could be a form of Batesian mimicry, but not in the strict sense. Also, these are one of the smallest sphinx moth species of over 50 that have been recorded in this state. The one that we have here is pretty much ready to pupate. This plant that it's feeding on is Borehavia, otherwise known as a spiderling. And if I'm not mistaken, Borehavia is the only genus of plants that these Proserpinus terlooii feed on. These Borehavia are also a popular choice for some other sphinx species as well. For example, in a recent video, we saw that the white-lined sphinx also feeds on these plants. And even though these are critically imperiled, like I said at the beginning of this segment, in some areas in southern Arizona at the right time of the year, it is possible to find several of them living within a meter of one another. We have another longhorn beetle, and it's also hanging out in a desert broom, like the last one, and it also has the same body size as that Dendrobias that we saw. And this is a species of Tragidion. I think this one is Tragidion densiventre. And it might not be the most spectacular, but I thought I would show you another orange and black longhorn beetle after we saw the Dendrobias, on the account of a sort of trend I've noticed in diurnal longhorns like this one. So it's quite likely that these are aposomatic, quite like the rainbow grasshopper I was showing you earlier. And if it is aposomatic, it could be exhibiting Batesian mimicry of a tarantula hawkwasp, which have a black body and orange wings. This color combination seems to be specifically popular among diurnal, medium-sized longhorns. And on the other hand, smaller aposomatic longhorn beetles tend to more frequently be yellow and black, perhaps due to the fact that smaller wasps are often yellow as well. And slightly unrelated, I did see a tarantula hawk attacking a smaller yellow wasp near this area that we are in. That was the first time I had ever seen a tarantula hawk attack anything other than a spider. And focusing more specifically on this particular beetle, in Arizona, beetles in this genus Tragidion are incredibly easy to identify, as there are very few longhorn beetles in this state with these velvety, almost golden elytra. Also, speaking of morphology, these are quite sexually dimorphic, like the last longhorn that we were looking at. The one that we have here is a male. The females have antennae that are about half this length, and their antennae are also black. And the females are generally darker in appearance too. Quite a crazy find down here. This is a Citheronia splendens moth, and I just watched it fly down from the trees up there. And now it's resting down here in the grass, and it appears that it was attracted by my flashlight. Currently, it is September 22nd, so this is an extremely unusual occurrence. It's difficult to overstate just how unlikely it is to come across one of these moths this late in the season. As I was saying earlier, these moths are supposed to be in flight from July to August. The window of activity for these moths in the United States is generally quite strict, and it's pretty much unheard of to find them in September, especially this late in the month. So again, I really wasn't expecting to see one of these moths, but there are a few more things that I can say about this species. The larvae do not exclusively feed on the desert cotton that I was talking about earlier. These can also be found on some species of sumac, and have also been recorded eating pointleaf manzanitas. They will also feed on some trees that are not found in their native range, such as walnut. And there are probably some other less well-known hosts that the caterpillars feed on in Mexico. Speaking of which, like I mentioned earlier, the moths of the species don't vary much, but the variation in the caterpillars is interesting. In terms of morphology, for example, it appears that many of the caterpillars in Mexico have shorter horns near their head, and in terms of coloration, some Mexican populations can be light gray, even appearing to potentially mimic lichen, and the mid-sized individuals, like the last one that we looked at, in some populations are nearly black. There are 20 or so species of Citheronia, or royal moths. Three of them can be found in the United States. This is the only one that is found in the West. The other ones are effectively eastern U.S. endemics. Well, that was certainly an unexpected addition to this video, but I think I'm going to end it here. So I hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.